On the 13th of January, then Taiwan's diplomatic ally Nauru, among many other countries in the world, congratulated Taiwan's president-elect Lai Ching-te on his winning of the election. However, in merely 2 days, out of the blue came the shock of the news of Nauru's switching allegiance from Taiwan to China and recognizing China as the only China in the world. To put it in context, over the past 8 years, Taiwan has lost 10 allies. What's happened? What does all this mean? I'm joined today by Raymond Sun Chen-en, PhD candidate in international law at Oxford University, board member of Taiwan New Constitution Foundation, and vice president of Prospect Foundation, to talk about the silent front line of Taiwan's legal warfare. Well, for starters, does it sound as bad as it appears?
Well, that depends on how your perspective about so-called Taiwan's diplomatic allies. What does it mean? Actually, Taiwan has been a de facto state. We have our own borders. We have our own government. Our people enjoy every kind of human rights and freedom in the world. In every aspect, Taiwan is an independent country. The only one aspect is lacking, which is international recognition. Taiwan is not a member to the United Nations. Taiwan is not allies or remains diplomatic ties with any major countries in the world. So we call it as a de facto state or unrecognized state. So the diplomatic allies you mentioned about the number now is 12,
right,
means that a country which formally recognized Taiwan as an independent state. That number is dwindling in recent years. But Taiwan as a thriving democracy and the economy does not being affected at all.
Right, because in Taiwan there have always been some mixed views as to how Taiwan should maintain its diplomatic allies. And, you know, for example, now the 12 are from the Pacific Ocean, Latin America, and the Vatican City. So just how important is it for Taiwan to keep those diplomatic allies?
Okay, so for that, we must be delving into the history of those. And the history has something to do with the fighting for the legitimate Chinese government. That was an attitude adopted by the Chiang Kai-shek, which brought his forces and his ROC government to Taiwan after 1949, after the ROC was defeated by the PRC, or the Mao Zedong forces, Communist China. But the KMT, or the ROC government, still maintained that ROC represents the whole China. And that attitude happened to be supported by the United States. And the consequences of that is that Taiwan remains a wide recognition among states. And those countries who recognize the PRC became a minority, as for example, only among major powers, only in the United Kingdom and the India recognize the PRC. But as time goes on, the fantasy cannot maintain, because Taiwan, what the ROC occupies is only Taiwan, Pescador, and Kinmen and Matsu, the four islands. And it cannot be a sustainable position that it represents the whole China. And for the international affairs, you must have the involvement of the real China, which is Communist China. So that legacy is really a fight between ideologies that, on the other hand, you have ROC, the Free China, and it maintains the right to recover all its territory, including the mainland, and you have the Communist China. However, that change is only happened in 1971, when the United Nations, in deciding the Chinese seat, who should sit on it, shall it still be, should it still be the ROC government or the PRC government? The General Assembly adopted the resolution called Resolution 2758, which adopted that the PRC government should sit on the Chinese seat, and the ROC government withdrew from the United Nations. And as far as the United States are concerned, the position has been changing in 1979 when the United States switched its recognition from the ROC government to PRC government. So the issue is who represents China, and there are two governments competing for that. So that's the background. But as times go by, the ROC side more and more recognize itself as an entity apart from PRC. Majority of Taiwanese people don't consider nowadays that we are China and we should continue this struggle with the PRC government. Our diplomatic recognition nowadays in the views of the majority of Taiwanese has nothing to do with which country recognized the PRC. So the issue is no longer on this side, on the Taiwanese side, being seen as a fight for the legitimate government to represent China any longer. So that's the change.
Mm-hmm. But still, I mean, is it important to remain those diplomatic allies with the 12 countries now?
Well, it has benefits. It benefits in the way that not to strengthen the claim of statehood of Taiwan, because Taiwan has more important relations, de facto, factual relations, with major powers like the United States, for example. The closest allies we have, the United States supported the ROC from the Chinese aftermath of the Chinese Civil War to prevent the PRC, the People's Liberation Army, to cross the strait to take over Taiwan and to assist, for example, the first Taiwan Strait crisis in and second one, 54 and 58. United States provides the logistic support for the ROC army. And nowadays, United States supported the decision-making or the rights to make our own decision by the Taiwanese people. That is enshrined in the United States 1992 Taiwan Relations Act. Mm-hmm. In all that aspect, the United States, the most important allies with Taiwan, but without formal diplomatic relations. In terms of the countries we remain formal diplomatic relations, they supported us. They speak for us in international forum, and they could facilitate the proposal making on our side. And they also facilitate, for example, the trips of our leaders or presidents. When they have to travel into America, we could transit through America and go to the final destination, our own formal diplomatic allies. So yes, we have a web of different international relations with either formal diplomatic allies or informal diplomatic allies.
Both are very critical, right?
Yeah, very, very much so. Taiwan is very much an international actor, yeah.
Yeah, interesting. Because our allies have been taken away one by one over the past 8 years. And the question could easily come as, so what should we do? Because it seems so easy for China to take our ally
yes.
away. Look at all the events. For example, the very latest one, it is our election. And then we got one ally yeah. off. And last year, I guess it was around March.
Yeah.
Because yes. we...
2023.
Yeah, we
Honduras.
Lost Honduras. Yep. So what should we do to prevent this from happening?
Okay, so if we delve deeper into the causes or the triggers of the so-called switch of the diplomatic recognition, each have its own individual circumstances. To take Nauru, for example, actually has something to do with Australia and Nauru's financial difficulties. Mm. You know, if you want to know more, I can tell the story. Australian set up a program to build the immigration centers in Nauru to process application of refugee and immigration. And that's for an extraterritorial dealing with immigration problem, because for every country, immigration is a very sensitive issue. And to facilitate that, Australian renders a large sum of financial assistance to Nauru. But unfortunately, that program has to be called off. And so Nauru is getting into financial troubles then. And so Nauru turned to Taiwan, its diplomatic ally, for assistance. But the sum is such a huge amount that Taiwan is not willing to bail that out. So it turns to China. Actually, so you see, it's a geopolitical issue. It's not really a competition between Taiwan and China, only bilaterally, no. It has something to do with geopolitical strategy and the other party like Australia and the United States. And of course, we are now talking about after Nauru, shall we worry about Tuvalu, for example. There's also a Pacific Island state, and it also has some need for assistance. But and this also holds the strategic positions, especially for Australia. So it's really for the allies or the democratic countries to put how much emphasis on maintaining Taiwan's diplomatic allies. On that connection, we must mention an act passed by the United States Congress called Taipei Act,
right,
to Taipei Alliance relations strengthening and enhancing, which says United States should help to protect Taiwan's diplomatic allies, even to that it could encourage countries to remain diplomatic allies to Taiwan and so-called punish those countries who sever diplomatic relations with Taiwan. So that's a clear signal. And if the all kinds of countries could adopt the same position, that will help Taiwan to maintain its diplomatic allies. And for example, Nauru is not the first time, the flip-flop.
Right.
In 2002, it switched diplomatic recognition to PRC, but in 2005, switch back to Taiwan again. So you see, that's the causes is financial aid. Who could offer you a more handsome sum of financial aid, it will switch diplomatic. That's the first cause. The second one is what you mentioned about the idea of punishing Taiwan. If Taiwan do something that's to the dislike of the PRC, PRC might use the severs of the diplomatic relations of Taiwan to,
they were all
as a punishment.
Very times, you know. You did this, we took one away, you did that.
But the problem is that it did it time and time again, and people are really tired of it, you know. Because, okay, what does China want? What does it want to prove? Does it want to prove it's very strong? Yes, we know that. It's the second biggest economy in the world. And in terms of the influence in the world, in the third world, in the global south, or in the United Nations, yes, you are predominant. We are no way to compete.
No competition.
Yeah. So what do you want? Okay. And even to strip Taiwan's own statehood, no, we are get used to it because that's what we got. This is nothing new. So that kind of punishment is really not really effective. And it uses, bring out a bad tendency, which means that it encourages certain country to see the money and not the real meaning of diplomatic allies. For example, do you consider Taiwan as a state? And do you consider Taiwan that could provide some friendship and benefit for you? Actually, for every allies Taiwan has did quite a lot. For example, agriculture or personnel exchange, medical assistance. Taiwan has do really, really good for the local communities. And you have, for example, you mentioned Honduras last year, which last year severed its relations with Taiwan on the taking the bay of China Sea, saying that China could provide a large market for Honduras shrimps export. It turned out to be a fantasy. It's nothing delivered there. So Honduras farmers now are trying to get back to Taiwan because Taiwan has really done something good for local community, but China doesn't. So I don't think the wisdom of Chinese policy of punishing Taiwan by this is really a good diplomatic practice.
Not a sustainable
measure. It doesn't
measure.
Bring any good to the diplomatic world, I will argue.
Right, because you spoke of the case of Honduras, and I want to further this topic by addressing one interesting remarks by our foreign minister, Joseph Wu, because last year he said that we don't rule out any possibility of fostering a relationship with
right.
any countries which wanted to work with us. And further to what you just said earlier, that when we left the United Nations, we thought that there would never be two Chinas, only one China. And if the world wanted to recognize PRC, then we walked away.
Yep.
But now Joseph Wu seemed to open this Pandora, you know.
Pandora box. Yes, right? I hope so.
Tell us what that meant for Taiwan in the
future.
That
has something to do with what I just tell you just now about the legacy of competition for the legitimate government which represents China. And I think the Pandora box says we don't have to think about Taiwan's diplomatic relations in that lens. Mm. Okay, we can think in other ways. For example, I said earlier before that for most Taiwanese people, our diplomatic relations has nothing to do with PRC. Our existence, our own governance, mm-hmm. the way we vote. If you want to take into consideration what PRC sees as, PRC's position, we will have a lot of troubles. We don't do that in Taiwan. We act, we govern ourselves, we act in our own ways. And that applies to diplomatic allies. And so more and more people in Taiwan which think that, why? Why do you, Nauru, Honduras, why do you have to sever diplomatic relations with Taiwan in order to build diplomatic relations with China? You don't have to. You could have both ways. That you could recognize you have relations with South Korea and North Korea, the DPRK yeah. and the ROK. Yeah, that's the same, although the two Koreas maintain their policy until recently in January, that Kim Jong-un said that he does not seek unification anymore. But they formally still maintain the policy of seeking unification. But there are two Koreas, no problem, everybody. And two Koreas belongs to the United Nations as member mm. states.
Yeah.
Why could we? So that has several factors, reasons. The first one is the historical one on the Taiwanese side under Chiang Kai-shek and the old ROC regime. It considered itself as Chinese, but nowadays Taiwanese consider themselves as Taiwan more and more. So that factor is gone. Then the problem is the PRC's attitude. PRC still adopt that Taiwan is a province of China. Taiwan cannot have diplomatic relations. So it will do everything to prevent Taiwan getting into formal diplomatic ties with other countries. That causes a lot of problem. And could we persuade China to change the position? Not in the near future, unless there's a change of mind or change of brain in the major decision maker in the Communist China, because it still remains the old doctrine mm-hmm. that gives us much trouble, not only in diplomatic realm, also in security realm, like that Xi Jinping has not renounced the possibility of using force to achieve the so-called unification of the mother country, so which causes international concern about the security and stability of the Taiwan Straits. So that doctrine is really not a peaceful one and not causing the greater good for the world in community.
So Raymond, it seems that it is we who, you know, took the first step to kind of shake off our doctrine, right? We become more flexible in a way to test the waters at least.
Someone has to do it.
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
Well, if we could not think out of the box, you know, the change will never happen.
Yeah, and right? A real alternative.
Right.
Interesting. Now, let's also look at this development, because we just lost one ally. And looking ahead towards the 20th of May, when Lai Xing-de will be in the office, what could possibly happen? You know, would there be another economic coercion, another diplomatic move against Taiwan by China? Do you envisage?
Yeah, there has some theories, and it's not all impossible, it's very likely that China is seeking a way to vent its dislike and dissatisfaction. Of course, if you take the perspective of the PRC, the democracy in Taiwan is really it's pain.
Yeah.
Because China is an authoritarian state. Chinese people don't have freedoms and human rights, but a successful democracy, successful economy has been built in Taiwan. The Taiwanese people, the majority of them, Han people, share the traditional Han's culture, Han Chinese culture. So it breaks the theory that the Chinese people is not eligible for democracy. That's a lie. And it proves that it could be have mature, the democracy can mature. So the very existence of Taiwan is very painful for China. Mm-hmm. So you understand why he's so dissatisfaction. And its fantasy cannot last, because if Taiwan it were a province of China, why could they elect their own president and vice president and the congressman and women, and it has its own army and the navy and the air forces. So that really tears the Chinese fantasy into lies. Of course, to vent this dissatisfaction and anger, it feels that Chinese feels that they have to do something. And all sorts of possible resorts, economic sanctions, for example, banning export of Taiwan's agricultural products, fruit, to China. But you must take notice, they never sanctioned Taiwan's ICT products to China. Because why? Because they need it. Their manufacturing industry need Taiwan's components. So they rely on Taiwan, on the ICT. But for the farmers, and military coercion, for example, putting up some military exercises. For example, 1996, when we first elect our own president, China tested missile firing just off the water of our two major ports. And after Nancy Pelosi's came in August 2022, it announces the six block exercise or near blockade around Taiwan. So military coercion, and other, for example, diplomatic punishment, or for example, there is an economic pact called ECFA between Taiwan and China. That is, there's talk about not only to withdraw some benefits from under that regime, it could be withdraw tear down totally. And also daily happening, the excursions, air excursions to across the midline of Taiwan Strait, or fly over, or the ships sail over our defense zones, and also gray zone activities, for example, dredging along the pescatores coasts or Mazu's coasts, or the fishermen's crossing the boundaries, might be a disguise for the militia. Guerrilla so all sorts of gray zone tactics could be used. But I think the point is that Taiwanese people has been seeing all those.
Yeah.
Right. And so it's because we've been here for so long, and that kind of situation, at least if you count until as far as 1996, is almost 30 years, and we've seen it all. Yeah. So it has really, really little effect on Taiwanese people, which angers China even more.
Right. Well, yeah, it's still a very predictable future, right? Because they also realize that all the weaponry they use doesn't reach some satisfactory results. But what else can they do, right? It becomes more and more difficult for them to really threaten Taiwan in a way. I wonder, because we just talked about our diplomatic allies, you know, and some implications. But here is the hypothesis I want to bring to you. Let's imagine this. What if one day we had zero diplomatic allies? What does it mean then for Taiwan?
Okay.
Yeah.
It will not mean that Taiwan is not a state. Okay. To judge what Taiwan is a difficult one, but I will suggest it to our audience that Taiwan is the de facto state, which is a factual existence, a state. In every way, it is a state. Mm. It's not widely recognized, so it's an unrecognized state. That status will not be affected. For example, if all our diplomatic relations has been taken away, we will still be here. And we will not be listening to what Beijing says. We will still remain our democracy. We will still have our own Congress to make our own laws. We have our own machine of government.
But Raymond, would it be a big deal if we have no voice at all, you know, in the United Nations?
Well, it's a digital world. It's a globalized world. There's many, many channels to know about this place. For the election just passed in January 2024, about more than hundreds, about 300 international press and journalists are here to scrutinize the election and knows about how Taiwanese people think. That's a huge, huge, big news in January. There's not possible, and Taiwan is a free country. Taiwan is not a country in which that if you're filming on public spaces that people will come up to you to say you cannot film here because I need to obey Chinese law. You know the recent incident in the department in London, it happens to a YouTuber. Taiwan is a free country, and the world press, the world, the people will have every right and very, very transparent ways to know about Taiwan. Actually, Taiwan has become a major tourist destinations in this part of the world and welcomed by many, many people. Whoever has visited Taiwan, as you can testify, will love Taiwan. So Taiwan is just such a good place that everybody knows more about it. So and more and more sympathy is paid with the Taiwanese people because we demonstrated our stamina and determination and resilience to pursue our own way
of life
and to the success. So that's the Taiwanese spirit. We want to, our followers, we want our young generations will follow.
Let's talk about the official, unofficial ties now. Because
right.
We just, you know, went through all the official ties. I just want to bring this example, which was very interesting for Taiwan. In 2021, we set up an office in Lithuania.
Yes.
And it was called, which was very different from all the rest of the offices across the world. It was called Taiwanese Representative Office in Lithuania.
Yes.
It might not sound like a big deal, but to Taiwan, it means a lot, right? It's the very first of its kind in Europe.
Yes.
Because typically, let's take the UK, for example.
Right.
Our office there is called Taipei Representative Office
Taipei.
In the UK.
Yes.
So it begins with the word Taipei.
Yes.
And let's take another example in Southeast Asia, Thailand. Our office is called Taipei Economic and Cultural Office in Thailand. So it sounds very soft.
Yes.
Beginning with Taipei and then economic and cultural.
Yeah.
So it doesn't sound like an official, you know, embassy.
No.
Not at all. But it is a de facto embassy,
yes.
So to speak.
Yes.
And so I just wonder, because now we talk about the official ties, which we enjoy a lot with our like-minded you know, neighbors or countries from different parts of the world. What are the implications or significance for Taiwanese to have Taiwan or Taiwanese in the name of the office overseas?
That brings me to introduce a concept called unofficial status or official status. And that the term difference between the terms carries that connotation. If you call this Taipei, like our teams to compete in
Chinese
Olympic,
Taipei.
Okay, or or in certain, for example, in WTO, we are called Chinese Taipei, which means that you are not a country, you are not a state, you are different.
You are an attachment, you know, belonging to China.
So anything carries the Taipei, to use the term Taipei to call Taiwan means unofficial, that we don't recognize you, but we want to maintain substantive relations like trade and cultural exchanges with you. So we set up an office, but it cannot be called an embassy. It has to be a representative office, and it cannot use Taiwan because your formal country name, state name is not Taiwan. We can only call you Taipei. So that carries the connotation that it's unofficial. It's not a formal diplomatic relations. And so that's the connotation. If you use Taiwan, that's very good. But if you cannot use Taiwan, you use Taiwanese office, that's better than Taipei. So that's why the Lithuanian representative office carries the name Taiwanese, is triggered Chinese anger toward Lithuania, and it used sanctions against Lithuania, but to the detriment of China. Why? Because the EU countries supported Lithuania a great deal. Mm-hmm. And I must say one thing. The relations between Taiwan and the Central East European countries, especially, for example, Czechia and Lithuania, it's a value alliance. It's not an interest alliance. We refer to that. It's because those countries has experienced the life under the communist regime.
Soviet Union.
They knew about the fight and struggle for a people to really establish their own democracy and to maintain its own freedom. So they have a lot of sympathy to Taiwan, and especially after the Ukraine war. Because the Ukraine war shows that if you are neighboring authoritarian regime, which happens to be a military mighty regime, your security will be in threat. And it stretches not only to Ukraine, but to the whole Europe. And the same parallel situation happens in Taiwan Strait. And Taiwan is standing on the first front of the against Chinese expansionism. So we have sympathies and supports from the Central Eastern European countries, more than other European countries. So it's a value alliance.
Is there a chance that this so-called trend, circulate among the European countries? Because the Eastern side of Europe, they learned the lessons, in their history. And could they influence other, let's say, Western European countries to follow suit at one point in the future? Because the world has shifted so quickly, and a lot of countries have already announced very clearly in their paper that they treat China as a systemic rival.
Oh, yes. That's reflected, for example, in NATO's strategic papers, and the EU's and also Federal Republic of Germany's Chinese white papers. And to see China as a systemic rival and also a competitor, but they will cooperate when in areas where they can cooperate. And with that influence, how they name Taiwan or treat Taiwan, I must be very, very honest with you that the majority of people, especially in Europe and also other areas, see this as a sensitive issue because they will anger China. Yeah. And they want to maintain a normal trade relations and also to have a good term with Chinese government, for example, in order to cooperate with the international organizations like the climate change regime or United Nations in general. So they don't tend to trigger angers from China. That will be to their detriment. So I must be very honest that, of course, even for Lithuania, there is a debate within the country to whether that to name Taiwanese office as a Taiwanese one is a wise move or not. And it could be even subject to change, I'll be perfectly honest. And actually the Taiwanese people understand this, and that's a structural problem that cannot be solved one by one. I think the Taiwanese people and Taiwanese government is wise enough, are wise enough to not persuading actively this, because it has to be have a wholesome solution like what has achieved between the two Koreas. So we will respect, I think our government will respect the decisions made by the friendly nations and their government.
So yeah, the office in Vilnius is more of a symbol, right? It doesn't really mean that we have to go down that path asking all our like-minded partners to follow suit, because maybe it essentially doesn't benefit our peers a lot.
Also, one connection is that if your friend do this for you, they have high expectations from you.
And also under huge pressure.
Yes, and you have to deliver, and you have to do something in
return.
In term. And especially, for example, they will very much like the high-tech investment in Lithuania, which of course our embassy there is doing very much to try to facilitate that. It's not impossible.
Right. Okay. Let's zoom out from Europe or from any region in particular and focus on the whole world map. For many years, I'm sure you know best that Taiwan has been, under a lot of threats from China, from, those battleships or fighters to legal warfare front. And you are the expert in laws. I wonder whether or not you could name us a few of the past years, the examples of legal warfare campaigns launched by China against Taiwan. Just some examples.
Okay, legal warfare. Legal warfare is a recent phenomenon, which means that use law as a weapon, as an aggressive one. The most familiar one is so-called the weaponization of trade. To take the Lithuania as an example, when Lithuania set up this Taiwanese office, representative office in Vilnius, and Chinese sanctions Lithuania, but Lithuania doesn't have a huge amount of export to China. So what did China do? China sanctioned German companies which use Lithuania supply chains components in order to force Lithuania, to put pressure on Lithuania. So it's a weaponization of trade. That happens to Lithuania, that happens to Australia. When Australia in 2021-22 made the proposal in the United Nations that we should set up an investigation team to investigate the sources of the COVID-19, the Chinese government was very angry. And what did they do? They store all the import of wine, Australian wine, lobsters, and barleys, and to just freeze it in their port to let it rot. Okay, but they also banned the Australian raw materials like coal, but Australia could find other alternative routes into China. So that's weaponization of trade. That's the first warfare. Generally, trade is for free trade. Actually, WTO was set up for that purpose. But there sometimes will be using commodities as a weapons. In the 70s, it's the oil war, when the Arab states express their angers to the Western states by banning their export of oil to the Western countries. And nowadays we see Chinese are using the same market status to do that. That's the first type. Legal warfare, meaning also to create an ambiguous basis in law. The most prominent example is in the South China Sea. In South China Sea, China maintains a nine dash line in the shape of a tongue, and went deep into the South China Sea to the border of Vietnam and the Philippines. And for them, they have a 200 miles economic zone, but the nine dash line encroaching to that, their economic zone. So who is right and who is wrong? The Philippines put that question into an arbitral tribunal to settle that legal dispute, which ruled that the Philippines won, and Philippines should have this 2,200 nautical mile economic zone, and Chinese claim has no basis in international law, but China still use might to enforce that line. So warfare meaning that you create a fantasy legal claim and you try to maintain that, but when you challenge and you fail, you still maintain that with your might. This saying said might makes right, or might cannot makes right. If might makes right, then we are living in a jungle rule.
Yeah,
it's not a civilized world. So in civilized world, there will be warfare, but there will be a dispute settlement by according to law.
Yeah.
That's the application of national law. And I must say that might makes right cannot sustain, because more and more country now says the South China Sea arbitral award is the law and China should obey the law. Although it did not refuse to participate in that, but the law has been made, the law has been announced. So to maintain an illegal claim, it takes a lot of cost and a lot of money. It cannot go on forever. So that's the human society. If you happen to live by a bully, he will knock on your door and bang on your door every time, yeah. But that couldn't go on forever.
Yeah.
And even police will be afraid that there's no police patrolling this area, or even the police are being bought up, but it cannot go on forever. Someday, the law will prevail. So that's the law of fear. So using law as a weapon, especially more and more to illegal use. For example, one more example. In China, especially in Hong Kong, there is a Hong Kong national security law, which claims so-called extraterritorial jurisdiction. If a Hong Kongese who flee to the United Kingdom, for example, and organize an anti-China and pro-Hong Kong group, Chinese will say that you violate Hong Kong national security law, I will prosecute you. And if you came across Hong Kong or the Chinese airport, the Chinese police will arrest you. It's a so-called extraterritorial jurisdiction. So one example I alluded to earlier, recently in London, there's a Dr. K pianist who will play piano to entertain everyone passing. And when he did that, one day a group of Chinese people came up to him saying, "You cannot film here." He said, "Why?" They say, "Because you are going to put your film on YouTube, and we cannot be shown on your YouTube because it's against Chinese law." Dr. K said to them, "It is Britain. Why do I have to obey Chinese law?"
It really went beyond people's understanding of the world.
That's the extreme form of extraterritorial of Chinese law.
Yeah.
Right.
You just talk about all these regions where disputes existed. But I think for Taiwan, it's even worse. You know, over the Taiwan Strait, when Chinese fighters pushed the median line.
All right.
Saying that, hey, this is our territory rather than international waters. And how can Taiwan just cope with this sustainably? We can't just fly our fighters every day, you know, 24/7 to really, escort them. In terms of resources, we can't really compete with them. So I think it's worse for Taiwan. But what do you say to some of our examples, in this Taiwan region?
Okay, that's not a law fear, that's really a military coercion. Okay, it's beyond law fear.
But they told the rest of the world that this is our internal waters. So that's part of the legal warfare efforts.
Now, as far as Taiwan Strait is concerned, Chinese one time used similar tactics it using the South China Sea to create ambiguity in the status of Taiwan Strait. It says that Taiwan Strait is water under its jurisdiction. That's the same term they used to the nine-dash line. But that's against the general interest of the international community because about 60% of maritime carriers and the trade, world trade, passes through Taiwan Strait. It goes through the Malacca Strait and South China Sea and cross Taiwan Strait. That's the most efficient route.
Yeah.
So it's against the general interest of Chinese. He seemed to put a pause on that. But the real intention, I will argue, it tried to raise the hurdle for the passing of warship across the Taiwan Strait so that one day if Chinese would, God forbid, would like to use military force against China, especially the middle power or the small navies will consider twice before they came to Taiwan Strait.
Yeah.
So that's the real intention. But that war still goes on. But as far as the law is concerned, it's very clear. The Taiwan Strait is very wide. It's wider than the 24 miles, so there is a high sea corridor across Taiwan Strait. It is a high sea that every vessel, even the warships, can pass through the Taiwan Strait. As far as the military coercion or threat you mentioned, of course, Taiwan is under that. And it's laying a burden on the ROC army, and that's the real purpose of POA. They want to exhaust you and want to tire you and want to compete with you to exhaust your resources. Actually, we have other means to maintain the order or to protect ourselves from invasion. We have a more advanced, for example, missile system. It's a radar system. Actually, I would say the Taiwanese army has done a very good job, decent job. For example, there's a warning 2 days before the general election about the firing of a rocket carrying a Chinese satellite.
Right.
And once it started and the route was judged to be abnormal, then the our army, our defense department announced a warning to the Taiwanese people.
That was within split seconds. Yeah.
Right. So it's an early warning system. It means that our detection capability is remarkable.
Yeah, truly. Although we have seen some controversies, but generally speaking, that means we are very precise, very accurate.
Or very alert.
Yes. Very high end. Now, you just spoke of invasion. I also want to talk about some hypotheses. Let's say when China really attacks, in terms of legal warfare, in terms of, let's say, legal protection from our allies, let's say the US and Japan, what can they do? Is there any framework available right now by the US or Japan to help us when all this becomes hot?
Yeah, there's no legal hurdle, for example, for the United States or Japan to be involved in any Taiwan contingency. No legal hurdle. It's the situation has never been like what Chinese says about that. It's an internal affair between Taiwan and China, or it's a continuation of the civil war of China. No, it's not a sustainable legal position. Why? Because nowadays, it's generally prohibition of against the use of force to settle any dispute. And even to give a million steps favor to China, even it is considered as an internal affair that you cannot use force to settle it. It's a general prohibition of use of force. That's the first thing. And the second thing, situation in Taiwan, especially in the Taiwan Straits, is in the international community's interest. Everyone in any nation, any state in international community has a say to it because it will affect everyone.
Exactly.
It will affect the maritime trade. It will affect the semiconductor deliveries. So to maintain an open and free access of Taiwan Strait is to the interest of every nation of the international community. That's the second thing. Third thing for the United States policy is that it's against the forceful settlement of the Chinese problem, it has to be peaceful. Mm-hmm. And that position has been maintained for decades. And actually to protect its own interests of military bases in Okinawa or in Japan,
right.
The United States will be involved in any Chinese move, and also Japan. Because of geographic proximity between Taiwan and Japan, and any Taiwan contingency will be a Japan's national interest threat. So Japan's self-defense forces will play this role, either in that it will provide the logistic support for the United States or be directly involved depending on circumstances. So in any case, the Taiwan situation or contingency is an international matter, and the security and stability of Taiwan Strait is an international concern. It's no returning from that.
How can we foster this notion that Taiwan is an international affair? I mean, we've been doing very hard from the Lithuanian office to all sorts of efforts from our diplomats here and there. What can we do? What kind of priorities should we focus on right now in order to give our partners and our neighbors the idea that it is an international affair, it deserves your attention, and this is for the good of your own people too?
Right, there's several branches of attempts or thinking. The first one is the government of Taiwan invented the slogan that Taiwan can help.
Yeah.
That's an advanced version of our rights to participate, for example, in the World Health regime.
Meaningfully.
Right, meaningful. And why being excluded, that we can do a lot more to the international, we can contribute. Mm-hmm. So especially in COVID period, when the Taiwan successfully resuscitated its production of health protection
yeah.
kits, and we have the capability to export or give it away. So we do that. We carry that, Taiwan can help, which is a soft way to say that to exclude us is to your own detriment, which should not happen. Mm-hmm. So that's the first thing. The second thing is more stark, which there's a think tank who calculate the economic cost of Taiwan being invaded. That will be huge. There'll be huge trillions of dollars in terms of, for example, the disruption of supply chain, especially for the high-end semiconductors and generally ICTs. Taiwan is a major powerhouse of ICT components. And to disrupt that, there will be to disrupt the world economy. For example, earthquake in Taiwan,
yeah.
right? This production line of our ICTs stopped. Every corner of the world feel that,
yeah.
right? Because you rely on daily supply of those components, and Taiwan is such a key occupier, key. Role in the supply chain. So the economic cost of Taiwan being invaded
Phenomenal.
Will be huge.
Yeah.
And also there's talks that in foreign ministries that we should formulate a plan to respond to that kind of circumstances so that we will minimize or at least have prepared for the disruptions. So that's why you see they try, many states try very hard to have TSMC investment and factories
yeah.
built in within them.
Yeah.
So that's also a way of responses that, which again is an evidence that how important Taiwan is.
Yeah. Well, Raymond, last but not least, what kind of message do you want to send to the audience who are so concerned about Taiwan? And want to know what they can help. Maybe they are from other parts of the world as a citizen of their own country. What can they do to meaningfully help Taiwan, counter any contingency from happening?
I think your presence in Taiwan itself is a good and strong support for Taiwan. Taiwan has suffered for a long time that been in neglecting the corner, and nobody cares and nobody knows about Taiwan, and which has been dramatic change in the last 3 or 5 years, 3 to 5 years. And due to the extensifying of the exchange of people-to-people relations between Taiwanese and the other countries, we have, of course, you must have lots of Taiwanese friends either in your own countries or in Taiwan, and you will find lots of visitors or residents of different nationalities in Taiwan, which is a community, and more people knows about it. It has generations, and there's a general rule, may I say, that people who come to Taiwan will fall in love in Taiwan. We've been assisted by, for example, priests from Catholic Church who devoted their whole career, in entire life, to the remote villages and the communities of Taiwan, and without any regret, but saying that they have a very, very fulfilling experiences in Taiwan. And then we have English teachers, spouses or friends or people who work in Taiwan. And now we have presses, we have all societies, corner like culture, language, education, engineering, or working.
Interlinked.
So Taiwan is now really, with your help, enter into international community, and people knows about Taiwan, and we have this channel, and you thank you for inviting me and to communicate with you directly. So the intensifying, the getting closer and closer on the people's side, is real the substance of all this. I have the privilege to welcome many high level visitors or judges. I translated to them the secret of me. I will always bring them to the very, very local life of Taiwan streets. One thing, sometimes in formal dinners, galas, they'll be tired and bored. But after that, when I brought them to, for example, 24 hours at Doujiang breakfast store, and to see the normal people sitting there chatting with other, relax on a street in the middle of the night. They know how safe Taiwan is. Their eyes brightened, you know. So once you know the real Taiwanese community, such a warm, friendly, big-hearted people, and open arm to the any visitors around us, you will love Taiwan.
Raymond, thank you for painting us such a wonderful portrait of Taiwan. And that is true.
That is
Whoever comes to Taiwan will say the same thing.
Right.
Thank you very much, Raymond.
Thank you so much. Thank you.